Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Matthew.
One of the 12, the man called Judas Iscariot, went to the chief priests and said,
"What are you prepared to give me if I hand him over to you?"
They paid him 30 silver pieces, and from that moment he looked for an opportunity to betray him. Now on the first day of unleavened bread, the disciples came to Jesus to say,
"Where do you want us to make the preparations for you to eat the Passover?"
He replied,
"Go to so-and-so in the city and say to him, 'The master says, my time is near. It is at your house that I am keeping Passover with my disciples.'"
The disciples did what Jesus told them and prepared the Passover. When evening came, he was at the table with the 12 disciples. And while they were eating, he said,
"I tell you solemnly, one of you is about to betray me."
They were greatly distressed and started asking him in turn,
"Not I, Lord, surely."
He answered,
"Someone who has dipped his hand into the dish with me will betray me. The Son of Man is going to his fate, as the scriptures say he will. But alas for that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. Better for that man if he had never been born."
Judas, who was to betray him, asked in his turn,
Not I, Rabbi, surely."
Jesus answered,
"They are your own words."
Now, as they were eating, Jesus took some bread, and when he had said the blessing, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said,
"Take it and eat. This is my body."
Then he took a cup, and when he had returned thanks, he gave it to them, saying,
"Drink all of you from this, for this is my blood, the blood of the covenant, which is to be poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. From now on, I tell you, I shall not drink wine until the day I drink the new wine with you in the kingdom of my Father."
After psalms had been sung, they left for the Mount of Olives. Then Jesus said to them,
"You will all lose faith in me this night. For the scripture says, I shall strike the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock will be scattered. But after my resurrection, I shall go before you to Galilee."
At this, Peter said,
"Though all lose faith in you, I will never lose faith."
Jesus answered him,
"I tell you solemnly, this very night, before the cock crows, you will have disowned me 3 times.
Peter said to him,
"Even if I have to die with you, I will never disown you."
And all the disciples said the same. Then Jesus came with them to a small estate called Gethsemane. And he said to his disciples,
"Stay here while I go over there to pray."
He took Peter and the 2 sons of Zebedee with him. And sadness came over him and great distress. Then he said to them,
"My soul is sorrowful to the point of death. Wait here and keep awake with me.
And going in a little further, he fell on his face and prayed.
My Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass me by. Nevertheless, let it be as you, not I, would have it.
He came back to the disciples and found them sleeping. And he said to Peter,
So you had not the strength to keep awake with me 1 hour. You should be awake and praying not to be put to the test. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak.
Again, a second time, he went away and prayed.
My Father, if this cup cannot pass by without my drinking it, your will be done.
And he came again back and found them sleeping. Their eyes were so heavy. Leaving them there, he went away again and prayed for the third time, repeating the same words. Then he came back to the disciples and said to them,
You can sleep on now and take your rest. Now the hour has come when the Son of Man is to be betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up, let us go. My betrayer is already close at hand.
He was still speaking when Judas, one of the 12, appeared, and with him a large number of men armed with swords and clubs, sent by the chief priests and the elders of the people. Now the traitor had arranged a sign with them. He had said,
The one I kiss, he is the man. Take him in charge.
So he went straight up to Jesus and said,
Greetings, Rabbi.
And kissed him. Jesus said to him,
My friend, do what you are here for.
Then he came forward, seized Jesus, and took him in charge. At that, one of the followers of Jesus grasped his sword and drew it. He struck out at the high priest's servant and cut off his ear. Jesus then said,
Put your sword back, for all who draw the sword will die by the sword. Or do you think that I cannot appeal to my Father, who would promptly send more than 12 legions of angels to my defense? But then, how would the scriptures be fulfilled that say this is the way it must be?
It was at this time that Jesus said to the crowd,
Am I a brigand that you had to set out to capture me with swords and clubs? I sat teaching in the temple day after day, and you never laid hands on me.
Now, all this happened to fulfill the prophecies of the scripture. Then all the disciples deserted him and ran away. The men who had arrested Jesus led him off to Caiaphas, the high priest, where the scribes and the elders were assembled. Peter followed him at a distance. And when he reached the high priest's palace, he went in and sat down with attendants to see what the ends would be. The chief priests and the whole of the Sanhedrin were looking for evidence against Jesus, however false, on what they might pass the death sentence. But they could not find any, though several lying witnesses came forward. Eventually, two stepped forward and made a statement.
This man said, I have power to destroy the temple of God, and in 3 days build it up.
The high priest then stood up and said to him,
Have you no answer to that? What is this evidence these men are bringing against you?
But Jesus was silent, and the high priest said to him,
I put you on oath by the living God to tell us if you are the Christ, the Son of God.
Jesus answered,
The words are your own. Moreover, I tell you that from this time forward, you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power and coming on the clouds of heaven.
At this, the high priest tore his clothes and said,
He has blasphemed. What need of witnesses have we now? There, you have just heard the blasphemy. What is your opinion?
They answered,
He deserves to die.
Then they spat on his face and hit him with their fists. Others said as they struck him,
Play the prophet, Christ. Who hit you then?
Meanwhile, Peter was sitting outside in the courtyard, and a servant girl came up to him and said,
You too were with Jesus the Galilean.
But he denied it in front of them all, saying,
I do not know what you are talking about.
When he went out to the gateway, another servant girl saw him and said to the people there,
This man was with Jesus the Nazarene.
And again, with an oath, he denied it.
I do not know the man.
A little later, the bystander came up and said to Peter,
You are one of them for sure. Why, your accent gives you away.
Then he started calling down, curses on himself and swearing,
I do not know the man.
At that moment, the cock crew. And Peter remembered what Jesus had said. Before the cock crows, you will have disowned me three times. And he went outside and wept bitterly. When morning came, all the chief priests and elders of the people met in council to bring about the death of Jesus. They had him bound and led away to hand him over to Pilate, the governor. When he found that Jesus had been condemned, Judas, his betrayer, was filled with remorse and took the 30 pieces of silver back to the chief priests and elders, saying,
I have sinned. I have betrayed innocent blood.
They replied,
What is that to us? This is your concern.
And flinging down the silver pieces in the sanctuary, he made off and went and hanged himself. The chief priest picked up the silver pieces and said,
It is against the law to put this into the treasury. It is blood money.
So they discussed the matter and bought the potter's field with it as a graveyard for foreigners. And this is why the field is called the field of blood today. The words of the prophet Jeremiah were then fulfilled, and they took the 30 pieces of silver, the sum at which the precious one was priced by children of Israel, and they gave them for the potter's field, just as the Lord directed me. Jesus then was brought before the governor, and the governor put to him this question.
Are you the king of the Jews?
Jesus replied,
It is you who say it.
But when he was accused by the chief priests and the elders, he refused to answer at all. Pilate then said to him,
Do you not hear how many charges they have brought against you?
No. To the governor's complete amazement, he offered no reply to any of the charges. At festival time, it was the governor's practice to release a prisoner for the people, anyone they chose. Now there was at that time a notorious prisoner whose name was Barabbas. So when the crowd gathered, Pilate said to them,
Which do you want me to release for you, Barabbas or Jesus, who is called Christ?
For Pilate knew it was out of jealousy that they'd handed him over. Now, as he was seated in the chair of judgment, his wife sent him a message.
Have nothing to do with that man. I have been upset all day by a dream I had about him.
The chief priests and elders, however, had persuaded the crowd to demand the release of Barabbas and the execution of Jesus. So when the governor spoke and asked them,
Which of the two do you want me to release for you?
They said,
Barabbas.
Pilate said to them,
What am I to do with Jesus, who is called Christ?
They all said,
Let him be crucified.
Pilate asked,
Why? What harm has he done?
But they shouted all the louder,
Let him be crucified.
Then Pilate saw that he was making no impression, that in fact a riot was imminent. So he took some water, washed his hands in front of the crowd and said,
I am innocent of this man's blood. It is your concern.
And the people, to a man, shouted back,
His blood be on us and on our children.
Then he released Barabbas for them. He ordered Jesus to be first scourged, then handed over to be crucified. The governor's soldiers took Jesus with them into the praetorium and collected the whole cohort around them. Then they stripped him and made him wear a scarlet cloak. And having twisted some thorns into a crown, they put this on his head and placed a reed in his right hand. To make fun of him, they knelt to him, saying,
"Hail, King of the Jews."
And they spat on him and took the reed and struck him on the head with it. And when they'd finished making fun of him, they took off the cloak and dressed him in his own clothes and led him away to crucify them. On their way out, they came across a man from Cyrene, Simon by name, and enlisted him to carry the cross. When they had reached a place called Golgotha, that is the place of the skull, they gave him wine to drink mixed with gall. Then he tasted but refused to drink. When they had finished crucifying him, they shared out his clothing by casting lots, then sat down and stayed there keeping guard over him. Above his head was placed a charge against him. It read, "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." At the same time, two robbers were crucified with him, one on the right, one on the left. The passers-by jeered at him. They shook their heads and said,
"So you would destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days? Then save yourself. If you are God's son, come down from the cross."
The chief priests with the scribes and elders mocked him in the same way, saying,
"He saved others. He cannot save himself. He is the King of Israel. Let him come down from the cross now, and we will believe in him." He put his trust in God. Now let God rescue him if he wants him. For he did say, "I am the Son of God."
Even the robbers who were crucified with him taunted him in the same way. From the sixth hour, there was darkness over all the land till the ninth hour. And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out in a loud voice,
"Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani?"
That is, my God, why have you deserted me?" When some of those who stood there heard this, they said,
"The man is calling on Elijah."
And one of them quickly ran to get a sponge, which he dipped in vinegar, and putting it on a reed, gave it to him to drink. The rest of them said,
"Wait, see if Elijah will come to save him."
But Jesus, again crying out in a loud voice, yielded up his spirit. At that, the veil of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth quaked, the rocks were split, the tombs opened, and the bodies of many holy men rose from the dead. And those, after his resurrection, came out of the tombs, entered the holy city, and appeared to a number of people. Meanwhile, the centurion, together with the others guarding Jesus, had seen the earthquake, and all that was taking place. And they were terrified and said,
"In truth, this was a son of God."
And many women were there, watching from a distance, the same women who had followed Jesus from Galilee and looked after him. Among them were Mary of Magdala, Mary, the mother of James and Joseph, and the mother of Zebedee's sons. When it was evening, there came a rich man of Arimathea called Joseph, who had himself become a disciple of Jesus. This man went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Pilate thereupon ordered it to be handed over. So Joseph took the body, wrapped it in a clean shroud, and put it in his own tomb, which he had hewn out of rock. He then rolled a large stone across the entrance of the tomb and went away. Now Mary of Magdala and the other Mary were there, sitting opposite the sepulchre. Next day, that is, when preparation day was over, the chief priests and the Pharisees went in a body to Pilate and said to them,
"Your Excellency, we recall that this impostor said, while he was still alive, 'After 3 days, I will rise again.' Therefore, give the order to have the sepulchre kept secure until the third day, for fear his disciples come and steal him away and tell the people he has risen from the dead. This last piece of fraud would be worse than what went before."
Pilate said to them,
"You may have your guards. Go and make all as secure as you know how."
So they went and made the sepulchre secure, putting the seals on the stone and mounting a guard.
In 2004, Mel Gibson produced and directed a film, The Passion of Christ. And in that film, there was very graphic detail about the suffering of one who was crucified at the hands of the Romans. You know, the crucifixion is really a form of torture. And this film really shows that in all its gory horror. And many people in the church said this was wonderful. Even a Scottish bishop who was alive at that time encouraged every Catholic in Scotland to go and to see this film, because he said it really shows the depths of how of Jesus' suffering, how he suffered for our salvation. I disagree with him. I think it's a horrible film. And if you've never seen it, I wouldn't encourage you to see it. And why do I say that? Is it that I want to diminish the suffering that Christ underwent for us? No. And crucifixion is a horrendous torture. But Mel Gibson misses the point. He doesn't get it. He does what all the four evangelists who wrote the Gospels avoided doing. They didn't emphasize the physical suffering of Jesus. You know, Matthew's Gospel that we've just listened to, there's no gory details. Sure, there's a bit of hitting, and there's when it comes to the actual crucifixion, it just says he was crucified with two robbers at either side of him. That's it. That's the detail that Matthew gives. He doesn't go into gory details. And they do that deliberately, the evangelists, because they don't want us to focus on the physical suffering. They want us to focus on what really matters here. And what they want us to focus on is the emotional and moral suffering of Jesus. This is about a lover struggling, not about an athlete enduring pain. This is about someone who loves us and the anguish and the passion that he went through. It's really significant. One of the first things that Jesus does after the Last Supper is takes his disciples to a garden, the Garden of Gethsemane. And at the end of today's gospel, what happens is that Jesus' body is taken by Joseph of Arimathea to a garden. Gardens are really significant in Scripture. And they're not just places for growing vegetables or growing flowers. They are places where lovers meet. The very first garden in the Scriptures, the Garden of Eden. Adam and Eve wandered through this garden naked and were not even aware that they were naked. It's a place for lovers. And in describing the gardens, the evangelists are trying to tell us that this passion is the passion of a lover, of someone who loves us. That's what the evangelists want us to focus on, this act of love. And Jesus prays to the Father in great anguish. Father, if this cup can be taken away from me, then please take it away. And what is Jesus' anguish? It's not about a fear of whips or nails being driven into his hands. It's an anguish about betrayal, about losing those that you thought loved you, about being abandoned and on your own. And even the ultimate anguish for Jesus, that he's abandoned by God himself. As he dies, his words are, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani? My God, why have you forsaken me? The anguish of Jesus must have been immense. He has lived his whole life trying to do the will of the Father. And at this point, he's anguished that the Father might have abandoned him. That's the anguish, the passion that the Gospels want us to focus in. And that passion of Jesus, that anguish of Jesus, is really a test for him. Because he has to decide what's going to happen here. Is he going to submit himself to this death, this unjust death at the hands of wicked people? Or is he going to call on God to send legions of angels to rescue him and to save him from that death? That's not the choice that Jesus is struggling with. The choice that Jesus is struggling with, the real choice, is this. How will I die? Will I die angry, bitter, and unforgiving? Or will I die with a warm, forgiving, and loving heart? That's the struggle that Jesus has. That's the choice that Jesus has to make. And we know from the gospel what choice he makes. You know, he's abandoned by those who are closest to him. He's abandoned by those he entrusted great love and great care with, the disciples. He's betrayed by Judas, the person that he entrusted to be the treasurer of this movement. And he's betrayed by a kiss, an act of love. And how does Jesus respond? My friend, do what you have to do. Would that be your response? My friend, who's sentencing me to death here, my friend, do what you have to do. He's denied by Peter. who denies that he even knows Jesus. Totally denied. The disciples have left him. He doesn't invoke anger with them. We're going to hear later on in the week and over the course of Easter how when he rises from the dead, he doesn't go back to them and say, "Listen, guys, where were you when I need you?" He didn't do that. He stands before the Sanhedrin and before Pilate to be tried. And what does he do? Does he defend himself? Does he try to plead his cause, to say, "Look, you're being unjust here. You've made a mistake"? No, he's silent. He's just accepting this in absolute love. That's the passion of Jesus. That he's faithful to the end to the teaching that he has proclaimed with his life. That proclamation that to love God is to love our neighbor. That love is the key to being a disciple of Jesus Christ. And Jesus lives that right to the end. He dies not angry, bitter, and unforgiving, but he dies in love, forgiving, and accepting. You know, in this Passion of Jesus that we celebrate today, on this Passion Sunday, it's not just a passion that we've to admire. It's a passion we have to imitate. We have to ask ourselves the question, how will I die? Will I die angry, bitter, and unforgiving? Or will I die with a warm, forgiving heart in gratitude for my life? You know, the moment of death, in answer to that question, will probably be determined by the way that we lived our lives. Do we live our lives in such a way that by the end of our life we will be angry, bitter, and unforgiving at the unfairness that we've received during our lives? Or will we die in that spirit of Jesus, that spirit of love? And the thing is, that question is not just about the end of life. That question is a question that we need to struggle with every moment of every day. You know, our Garden of Gethsemane moments, where we have to struggle to know what way will I go here, happens every day. Your Garden of Gethsemane is in your family home. It's in your schools. It's in your places of work. It's in your parishes. Because every day we are betrayed or let down by loved ones. We suffer at the hands of unfairness. We might even receive the hatred of other people. And we have to ask ourselves, how do I respond to this? Angry, bitter, and unforgiving? Or warm, loving, forgiving heart?